Aber since Bernard Kasch coined the term non-standard architecture, which happened in 1996 in his book that was called Earth Moves, and then in 2003, François Miguelou did the show of the same name in Paris, architecture migrated from a concept that was still related to modernism and economies of scale, that means the repetition of modular elements, into a new realm that was non-standard elements, that means all the elements were different. And I remember the people in the 90s talked a lot about how the architecture from the screen would be able to go into three-dimensional material reality. And that took a long time to develop the relative and or the relevant logics for this endeavor. And the thing that developed at that time was that before the machinic age, people that were producing material objects were craftsmen. In the end of the 19th century and the beginning of the 20th century, think of the Ford T model. Things were produced by machines in big numbers, but it only worked economically if all the things were always the same. That was called standard or modular thinking. And then with the non-standard architecture and with geometries that were, let's say, more complex than what people had managed until this time, and it was the computer to help them, and also biological models and self-organizing systems, that crafts had a re-entry in the thinking of people. But now it was not craft as we defined craft until the 19th century, but it was craft that was called digital craft. And this is also what Sliver has as its topic this year, which is called digital craft. And either by coincidence or by politeness, the speaker of this evening called his lecture Crafting the Digital. So, I mean, it's a kind of playing the ball back and forth. I welcome Fabian Scheuber, who is one of those people who makes it possible that non-standard architecture can really be built within a logic that is also economically supported or even makes sense economically. He holds a degree in information science, but and this is what I was talking to him before. The second subject was architecture. And he did this at the University in Munich and then went to teach and work for Ruko Rukestadt in the ETH in Zurich from 2002 to 2006, and in 2005 founded a research group within the university that was called Design to Production. And then, after a while, this Design to Production migrated out of the university, and this is the company that he is doing. And he's one of the most sought-after people to make your geometry from the screen work into reality in relating it to material and to production logic. And when you think of the Hummel Goodman, the Zaha Hadid, or the Rolex Learning Center in Lausanne, and more of this kind, it is Fabian Scheuber's expertise to make these things real.
It's going to be about crafting the digital, it's going to be about the craft of actually physical things, which I will touch on the slide. It's actually about what we do is building digital things that are then used to build physical things. It's already been said in the introduction, design to production is a consulting practice. We don't design, we don't build, we don't have any machines, we don't even have a 3D printer. Not even that. We're supporting architects, engineers, and fabricators in planning and building complex designs. And the first half of my talk I'm going to use to very briefly show you through a number of projects, really just a few slides, and the other half I'm going to talk about how we craft the digital. One of the very first projects that we did, still at the ETH, being a research group there, this was actually my sort of epiphany of digital fabrication. This is a small pavilion that we built for the Swiss Bauer Fair in Basel in 2005. My job there was, that's why I came to the ETH in the first place to approach, was to build a little self-organizing optimization system where arrange this coordinate information you can see here to the predefined openings on the screen. So this is actually the frozen outcome of a dynamic self-organizing system. And then a few colleagues of mine took over the output of my little Java program that I wrote there those times. Broke it down into actual fabrication data for a 5-axis CNC machine in carpentry that they got to know a bit earlier, who had a 5-axis machine that they bought out of another company who went bankrupt and did some things like that, cupboards and doors and stuff. But there was one guy who was really interested in building things and having the money for this machine and push it to the edge. This is how we came together to build this little sphere, about 4 meters long, as part of a 340 lateral frame, so the prefabricated at the carpentry and just set on top of each other till you got that sphere. I'm not going to show you the end result because the whole thing was covered with some like membrane, and it was one of the sponsors. Was the fabricator was quite good for me. But this is a much nicer image. This is the same thing from the inside. And this for me was an eye-opener in a way that I realized that for me it was pretty straightforward to build a self-organizing system, spit out nodes and members in a 3D model. And also for my colleague who was then working, I think, with vector nodes, it was an easy thing to do a few scripts to push it up into the next dimension with material thicknesses and connection details in the corner, but then there was a big gap bringing that to the machine. Basically, we did quite a bit of programming in 5x G code to the carpentry because it was not possible, which was new to me, to hand the logs and feed the model and then just build the thing. The ongoing process of digital fabrication in the way. That really never holds true. And that was the point for me to say, hey, there's actually a gap in that in the digital chain, and I've got to try to fill it up. A few years later, already basically on the verge of turning this research group into an actual professional practice, we were asked to build the foreword for the Robotics Learning Center in Plan 14. Interestingly enough, that was one of the very few projects where we were approached before the tender phase by the general contractor to plan this foreword. And then we're handed over to the actual foreword producer to finish. So this is the project. It's by Sana Art. Most of you will know it. It's in Lausanne. It's a one-story library building in Paris. Actually, a steel roof standing on its own undulating concrete slab, which is going up and down about 6.5 meters. The question there was, how do you actually build a foreword for 7,500 this hooked up in kind of form. What we did is we cut up 10,000 timber panels that were assembled to 1,500 of those boxes, formula tables. So we have 6 or 7 vertical teeth, CNC cut, and then a sheet of plywood on top of that. We multiply that by 1,500, put it on scaffolding tanks that are measured to the right height beforehand, and this formula. Here you can see all three faces basically. On the right hand side, there's a scaffolding that has a formwork box already on it. And on the left hand side, there's a rebar that's already put on top of it. The whole, it's two parts. This is the larger part of the project, about 5,500 square meters. They're in a casting window, I think, they're casting concrete for about 48 hours to get the quality. And then they pull out the formula boxes and shred them. That was our first timber building, basically, but the timber isn't there anymore. But this is a really, this is our first green timber building. Sancho Pompidou, the head spike, it's got an interesting story in the background that I will go into more detail later on, but what you can see here is basically a large straw hat of about 8,500 square meters. The straws in this straw hat are beam-laminated timber beams with a final cross section of about 40 by 44 centimeters. This is just a raw beam blank, so to say, or two of them, which were then put into a 5-axis machine center and carpentry, grinded down to the final shape within a few tenths of a millimeter, including all the connection details until they look like this, 1800 or more. Then shipped or driven to the construction site and then sort of put on top of each other in 6 layers in 3 different directions. Membrane on top of basically an outside space, so it's not heated. It's just a rain shelter. The actual museum is inside the concrete box underneath this shelter. It was an interesting experience for us. We just somehow stumbled into this project by calling up the timber fabricators we knew around our office in Zurich, telling them that we've done a little university project in Norway just before. Like this is going to be a and brought us right into the next Shigeruba project, this time further away, South Korea and Jeju. This is a very sophisticated golf club in South Korea. It's a bit the same structure, it's this hexagonal grid of curved timber beams. This time it's actually holding a flat roof, which is insulated, so not built in physics, but it's on top of the curved structure. We were glad that we had a bit of practice from the Sancho Pompidou, because this was a very thick project. From signing the contract with the fabricator, which we were looking for, until the opening was 7 months. You can subtract 6 weeks in a shipping container between Switzerland and South Korea, so you can see a bit more than 5.5 months of actual planning and fabrication of this thing. Fortunately, it's a bit more regular than the Sancho Pompidou, it's got a bit of repetition. You see those columns there, and basically the whole thing is put together from 32 roof elements with a 9 by 9 meter grid. But to make it a bit more complicated, this time Shigeruba didn't want to have the earth just passing each other nicely in different layers, but they intersected, which means you get a latch under the crossing with 50 centimeters more or less. This is what was shipped to South Korea from Switzerland, from 33,500 segments prefabricated, all the connection details. Then assembled into those 32 roof elements on a scaffolding on a chip inside a heated tent on the construction site because it's clean, so they need to have controlled environment, temperature, and moisture-wise. The good thing is they could work in t-shirts while outside it was minus something degrees in South Korea in February. And then those roof elements were put together, which is almost 2,500 square meter roof structure on top of the 21 columns. And then decked with a flat roof. The interesting thing here is it's basically furniture built in order to the structure and touch it. So this is the bar of the golf club on the top floor. The connections had to be as invisible as possible, which was a challenge. A very, very much smaller one is the kind of art project in Zurich last year. It's Vaporats. An artist, Mark Gantz, from Zurich. It stands inside a house in the building. 150 5-axis cut cutter boards, laminated from the layer boards, high density, cutter of one boards, 20 meters length, and then laminated into this. That was put up inside this courtyard. It's I think 17 layers of paint on this shiny almost long timber, but it's massive timber, it's a big black. Another small project in Paris. The shop is located inside my swimming pool. And the tubes are somehow structured. I don't know how many square meters. Three house baskets and also a staircase. That was the same fabricator that did the soldier concrete in the summer. But this time the slabs are thinner. We had to cut about 7,000 ashes in the month that were then laminated in 3 days because they still could be bent over a scaffolding. I think there were about 2,500 clamps. Put the things together. And then disassembled again, brought to Paris, put together again. If your parents go there, it's very interesting. Don't you think it's a bit of a larger project, and I'll show you many more details in the second half. This performing arts center, or actually the facade of the performing arts center, this is in Norway, by A&A Architects. That was a very interesting project because, again, we were called very late in the project. The concrete was already there. Basically, it's a rectangular concrete box in the back, and this rather dramatic front to the harbor side of the Christian summit. There they really had a few problems to get this facade done. So the concrete was already there, but they wouldn't even have to put the facade on. We were approached by a Norwegian timber contractor, which we knew from an old project 5 years before, that actually wanted to propose a timber solution for that, because it was a complete steel structure in the first round. Only the very thin oakboard layer on top was always there, but the steel started up. And then he turned it together with Swiss timber contractor, Swiss timber, and we have now inserted into a timber solution. It's built from about 300 straight and 1700 curved timber beams. They were put together into those frames or elements in a shipyard, which was where the and then added them all together about 12.5 miles of to form these rather large elements, which was another big change into the project. They wanted it on site, we changed into prefabrication. We were lucky that we were in Norway because we built this in a shipyard on the construction site right next to the water. So we actually literally shipped 50 square meter elements over the waterway, which would be impossible on trucks in Norway. And then hoisted into the steel structure that was hanging from the concrete structure to form this 3,500 timber facade. The interesting thing here is that the difficult part was to meet the quality of the requirements of the designers. They wanted to have those thin stripes going on the facade. It's 10 millimeter gaps between them. Straight up over 35 meters. Unfortunately, they have to cross about 5 to 6 joints between high-scale timber elements, so the tolerances were a bit of an issue. But it worked in the end. Then just finished, actually almost finished our only project so far in one reason. Again, I'll explain that a little bit. On the foot of a large skyscraper, four canopies designed by Nawaki from Australia, again, we were working for the timber contractor, this time a different one in Germany, to plan and create for 700 per use this time. They're not doubling enough, but a flat curve, which we then put together into this canyon as shading devices on up to the skyscraper, which was at 103 stories. And the last project I briefly show is another interior project for the Autostadt on Volkswagen in Wolfsburg, designed by Manhattan section. The playground inside the Autostadt for kids. It's a large scale climbing playing sculpture put together from 3,000 something CNC cut aerial boards. And the first cut out, then laminated into 61 miles, and then again put into another CNC machine to grind them down to the final shape. So this would be one component that was then transported to Wolfsburg to put together to this very human shape. That was quite an experience because we had to meet the German norms and standards for playgrounds, which are really interesting to me. And this is the really last project I'll briefly show, which is a trade fair show stand for Buick at the Shanghai Motor Show this year, which is designed by Belpart from Zurich, where we were also on the interior design phase, which was interesting because we were actually first on the commission to do the designer help the design this shape or wall put together by 180 of those sort of wings. And then they handed it over to the Chinese contractor to build it. But then you probably couldn't actually get these two colors. It's another Chinese would do it. Sure enough, the Chinese called us 4 weeks before the opening. Fabrication data for the design that they got from it's a bit tight, isn't it? No problem. So we were in the lucky place, which we usually are not, which I can explain, to have a very good model to start with, because we built it ourselves. So it was possible to break it down within a few days into 3,500 pilot parts and ship the data to China. And they were actually, that was something that was never experienced. I don't know how many 3X elements actually got done in there, but they milled those 3,500 put the thing together to those 178 wings that were then fitted with LED screens on the inside, very fancy. To form this structure. So you drop scale animations running around the inside box and as a result, it looks fantastic. So this is the normal range of projects we're doing. Probably notice some common denominator in there. It's always a lot of components with very different shapes, as well as. For a number of reasons, I somehow don't like the term non-standard, because basically those are all standard parts of them. Only the standard is a bit more flexible than the usual standard, and we don't even do so well. But they're all individual. I think the largest mod size we have in there is the usual project in South Korea, where we have 12 similar components. They're all only working with digital footage. So we get the precision and the efficiency that the mod size want, only if we use machines who don't care if they have a thousand different similar pieces. We can only do this by actually putting the complexity of the project into the components. So we're embedding the assembly information basically in some of those components. This is one of the beams of the South Korea project where you can see all those lap joints every 500 millimeters basically. So the point is we are doing prefabrication with very intricate detailing to save time on measurements. It would be closely impossible to measure those things on the curve structure on the site, so they just have to snap together like a puzzle. That's the main part of the measurement. So what we're doing is sort of a mass customization. We're doing standard parts, we're doing unique parts at the cost of serial production in a way that develop a standard for the very given project to mass produce or mass customize 3,500 parts for this project. Yeah. But you have to be very aware that unique parts at the cost of serial production means only the fabrication itself. That usually gets lost in all these discussions about mass customization is that also, if you buy mass customized shirts over the internet, or if you configure your car with an online configurator, BMW, say it's called the name, somebody already has to get up this whole new standard beforehand, which comes at some expense. The actual production doesn't matter. Every shirt more or less costs the same in fabrication. But the effort beforehand to set up this whole fabrication chain is what actually counts. And this is what we do. This is what we do in the project, is we set up those digital fabrication chains in those digital models. Sometimes they are alive. The Swiss bar sphere you see there on the left hand side, this is actually a real time screenshot movie of what happened in the development of this. Sphere that you saw as a very first project, and all the others are directly out of the fabrication lines that we did for the project. So it's all about digital models. It's about building models from data. Data is a fine thing, it's easy to store. This is a complete works of design production since 2005, the backup of our server. On a, I think, 1 terabyte hard drive. This is actually carrying it around most of the time because I'm too lazy to put it in my bag and clean it out again. It comes very handy. Not only will it be able to over the past 8 years. It's easy to transport, which is fine. It costs about 6 weeks to transport 3,500 timber beams from Osaka in Switzerland to Asia in South Korea. In 6 shipping containers. It takes about 5 seconds to transport fabrication data from 3,500 tons from Zurich Alpha to Shanghai to get 300,000 plywood boards more or less printed. I've never been to Shanghai, I've never met the guys. Just talked to them on the phone, which was difficult enough, and most communication was via email. In the end, there was a few emails of fabrication that they did this JFest from scratch. Another thing with data, of course, it's easy to copy. What that means for architecture, I don't dare to speculate. You probably know this, this is outside of the atmosphere. This is actually from China. So whatever happens if my hard drive gets lost and gets into the wrong hands, I don't want to imagine that. We'll see. But actually, it's not about the data. It's about the making of the data. You copy this hard drive and you can probably build another central computer if you want. The data is all on there. I don't care. For us, it's about the process. The making, the actual craft of building digital tools. And that's the question for us. What is a model? It describes reality, or does it actually describe the intention? So this is the straw hat. Shigeru Wang apparently draws his intentions from. The legend goes, he found it on a flea market in Paris. It's proudly on display in Metz. This is where I took this picture. Does the model actually describe this intention? Or what it actually does is, and this is where we got called into the project, as we fabricated up this model on the right-hand side, which is a DXF file with straight lines in between the nodes of the roof. And Shigeru Wang wanted to have continuously curved. So the model probably describes the intention, but it's definitely not enough to build this thing. Because when reality is continuous, the model can't be discrete. The reality should be a nice curve where the model has kinks and something has gone wrong. Which means our first step in this project, for example, was to take all those, this point cloud basically, and smooth them out by relaxing it a bit, and then finding something that could actually turn this point cloud into a continuous curve. And that was then the basis of describing this shape within the tolerances that we needed for building the fabrication model. In the end, we have to be aware that the fabrication equipment used to build those models are working within some 10th of a millimeter tolerance. And they need to have, because the slot plates where the things come together are held in the timber beam by little steel dowels that have to be within, I think, 3/10 of a millimeter tolerance, according to the norms. So if you want to have a stick proof from your check engine, you have to be within the normal standard, which means the fabrication. It's not just a fetish to be that precise, it actually is a necessity. But on the other hand, if the fabrication equipment needs data that is precise to 3/10 of a millimeter, then means your 8.5 square meter roof digital model in the first place has to be at the same precision or even a bit more to actually deduct all the fabrication information out on the model. So the model has to be precise, which it hardly ever is when it reaches our office, I have to say. Which is not to blame the architects and engineers. No architect is actually built in one stand to the 10th of a millimeter. Because then it can pay for that. In the end, it's a fabricator who didn't. So the question is, on which basis are we doing this? What is a good description of the reality that is intended? And in the second Shigeru Wang project we did, it was much easier because we didn't get a point cloud in the beginning, we did get a napkin sketch, basically. That already listed the prerequisites of the geometry. It should be horizontal along this line, it should be at an angle of 67 point something degrees going down into this column, it should be this and that requirements. This is basically the whole description of the geometry of the leaderboard. If you have this, you can, more or less, generate those 5 reference interfaces to work more than one. Much easier than that. Much quicker. Fortunately, things are changing. Because at architecture schools, people started playing around with Grasshopper and other things. Suddenly, there is a completely different understanding of geometry and how to describe geometry than it was before. It's pretty normal to get meshes and loop surfaces where somebody had fumbled around with different nodes for half a year to get exactly this shape, and no one could describe how this shape came to be. Now you get a Grasshopper model and somebody who built it, if you're lucky, you can still describe how this model came to be. You have your perfect description of the geometry and the intention behind it. So basically what we're trying to do is we're trying to translate ideas into the computer. The form modeling is describing things, and if you want to build a digital model, you have to put it into a computer readable form, which is because computers are really stupid and not very imaginative, don't have any intuition, which has to be really precise. And we are sort of the translators in this game, taking intentions, trying to understand images sometimes, and translating them into a computer. This brings a few problems with it. What is the problem of scaling? You probably know this guy, Nathan. Assembly instruction here. Our problems usually look like this. So we have odd size. We don't have any repetition, which means we have to perfectly describe every single part or component of this project. Which is already difficult enough for something like a Swiss Pavilion with 1200 parts, but it's definitely a bit more complicated than what it's learning center formwork, which consists of 12,000 parts. It's actually not that difficult to generate those points. It's more difficult to hold it in one model that you can still work. And there's another problem when you come here. This is scaling the details. In the Swiss file, there's about 15 CNC operations in one of those nodes, 5 cuts, and then 10 notches for those dovetail connectors that hold everything together in the corner. And then the one canopy, which is not a particularly beautiful thing, I have to admit, but you have to work with what the engineers come up with. You have about 150 CNC operations to fabricate this now. So every single drilling, cutting, pocket, notch, whatever you need to get this fabricated has to be, because otherwise no machine will take it and fabricate it. If you multiply that by 150 or 200 nodes, you can imagine how many drilling holes are in this model. That means the total amount of information we have to give is actually growing in two directions. On the one hand side, the project sizes are getting bigger and bigger. The facade of the building concert hall contains about 14,000 individual components. And the whole model takes about, I think, 5 gigabytes on the smartphone that we've seen. And in the other direction, the level of detail is getting smaller and smaller, which also adds data to the thing. This is one of the, probably the worst component out of the 2x1 canopies. There's hardly any timber left because of the driven joints and parts for the connection for the steel connectors. If you put that together, the model is basically growing exponentially, which at some point actually makes problems. The problem is storage is cheap. It doesn't really matter how much information you have to carry around in your pocket, but the structure is expensive. The idea of just putting information onto the hardware and then expecting to find what you need within seconds is just not worth it. Of course, we're building parametric models. On the right-hand side, this is a part of this Wolfsburg climbing tower, I think, in the Autostadt, where there's actually every drilling hole in every little timber, including the diameter. course, we're using parametric models, sometimes using Grasshopper, most of the time actually not in Grasshopper, because Grasshopper won't be able to handle those 14,000 components, which you have to detail about in the screening model. But most of the times it actually starts with Grasshopper, and then at some point is turning over into whatever other language we're using, which could be Python and YAML. To build on the model, because we don't want to draw things, and hardly ever draw anything. We're going to program things. We're going to extract the rules behind it, extract it from the heads of the architects, of the engineers, and the things, and turn it into machine readable formulas across the model, which has a number of interesting consequences. One is, of course, we're actually only stylistically able to handle the detail. On the other hand, this very systematic approach makes it possible to actually also handle the risk that we're taking. You have to imagine the data that we send out to fabricators actually going onto the machine, sometimes without anybody even checking it before. You know, the machines sometimes milling down a couple thousand cubic meters of timber. Probably there, we would be bankrupt within a second. So the good thing is, if one is right, and that's something you can test in the early stages, more or less all of them, sometimes it goes wrong, as you can see here. Sometimes models are not connected together, and someone has optimized the number of cladding boards on the lower element, and you realize that you probably should also change the number of boards in all the following elements up to the ridge. This is the 30-something old rules that we have of 12,000 project, which I'm very happy, which I'm not very happy with, but it makes a failure rate of 0.5% or something like that, which is still acceptable, and you actually could pay for that. If it was the whole thing, it would have been difficult. So the problem also is we have to be very systematic in handling this data, otherwise it doesn't work. And that means modeling is actually a question of abstracting. The question is not to put as much data as possible into a digital model. The problem is to leave away as much as possible, to throw out everything that is unnecessary and just distracting or redundant that leads to error and inconsistencies. And only leave the stuff in there that's really needed. One for handling the amount of data, and on the other side, for handling the amount of risk that is in there if you're setting up fabrication data with 1,000 components. And that leads to another that leads to another question. Is there one model that serves everything in the project? Or are we actually modeling by objectives? So is there one model for the design, for the optimization, for the detailing, for the fabrication? This is something that if you had asked some BIM consultant 10 years ago, probably there's still a few around, you would of course answer yes, one big model where everything is in. We have a decisively different opinion about that. Because we learned that it starts with probably a reference geometry model that precisely defines the shape in the first place, which is difficult enough also in this project. So here, it looks pretty easy. It has a straight line on top and a curved line on the bottom, and then there's straight lines connecting the two, resulting in a ruled surface, which has the good effect that all of the swirled gaps that I showed in the image before are actually straight. And all the boards on the facade are straight too. There's a single curved one, which is twisted. But still there, it was difficult enough to actually define this this shape, because this doesn't come out straight of the standard modeling system. You have to be pretty aware of how you want in the surface around if you really want to get there. This is not the standard of the model that will lead you there. And also, it wasn't so clear for everybody in the field that this was the reason. At some point, someone twisted one of those lines a little bit, because he needed to make room half a meter or so for emergency exit behind the facade from the concert halls. By this, basically destroyed the geometrical and the constructive and the fabrication principle of the whole facade system. About 4 weeks of discussions to move everything back into normal and still fulfill the criteria of having executed right enough behind the facade. So it's not that easy. But this is a very small one. This could be a gross one. In the end, you have a fabrication model, the description of what components and interfaces in there. And interfaces in this case means connection details, about 60,000 in this facade, where things come together and have to be connected with one another. From this, you can get a structural view of the whole thing. Structural engineer wants to see different things in this facade. He wants to have, he doesn't need to have curves, he wants to have straight lines, basically. And he knows it in a very, very decisive way. To build those models to check if everything is actually holding up. And then you have to come up with three different workflows for three different component types. This is one of the simplification things I was talking about. There's 14,000 components in there, there are only three different types of components in this. Two straight beams in every element, there's a number of curved beams in every element, and there's a number of tanning boards. Something around 150 to 200 in every element of the facade. They all follow the same rules for the type. They all have distinctive fabrication logistic behind them. The straight primary beams are fabricated in all way into the constructor. Really sent final 3D geometry, so the actually 3D model of the final thing, he then translated that into fabrication data on his Hundegger machine, put in a few beams, and cut those 300 beams in Norway. For the curved secondary beams, which were fabricated in Switzerland, we were exporting raw 3D geometry plus a number of features. So this is not the final geometry of the beam, this is so the view laminated bank, the raw geometry, and for every little seat cut that holds the bolt later on, there's an extra surface. And they have a very experienced programmer themselves who then takes this mold and has its own scripts to turn them into fabrication data. Including also information for another fabricator that produces the raw material, which are and then the question is, you can imagine you laminate single boards into those kind of beams, and it takes about 24 hours for one single beam, because it has to go while they are in the present bed, which makes producing 1,700 different beams pretty slow. 1,700 days is really long, or you need to have more fabricators. Or you come up with the idea that actually the mine. These nine curved beams in this element are all different, but only slightly. So, with a bit of tricky optimization, you can actually all squeeze them into one blank, which means you can then make nine beams in the same pressing bed and just cut out the different shapes of the beams. It's not that easy because we are working in timber, so we have an anisotropic material which has fibers, which means if you cut the fiber, you're reducing the strength of the beam. We have to be very sure that you're cutting the fiber by less than 5 degree angle to make the engineers happy and everything, but with a bit of tricky things you can get all those different beams into one length geometry, and then just by using this, speeding up the process by the factor of 10, which is not bad. That's it, fabricated in Switzerland. And then we have a third production chain. This is ready to be shipped. And then we have the oak boards left, which are fabricated in another place, at the boat workshop in Norway, on this little machine, where we deliver the fabrication data directly into the machine, so they could actually put the USB stick into the machine and let go. Which makes complete sense if you have to do 12,500 boards. It takes a little extra for the long side, but it quickly pays off. And this is always a question. in the end, we're back to mass production. It is a question of numbers, it is a question of scale. This only makes sense from a certain amount of individual components and to stuff like this, rather complicated processing. But the actual lesson from this is the AEC business is incredibly fragmented. In every project, you have another ad hoc team from 10 to 12, 15, 200 players, which is somehow have to work together. And this is what the workflow is also like. They're always fragmented. So we have an architect on the left hand side that issues a VXF file in the case of the central company. Someone has to do some surface reconstruction. That with the actual 3D panel, and then everything just opens wide up to different engineers, aggregators, consultants. The question of including all this in one single model, I think, is a bit unusual. There is now a multitude of different file formats that are being used, and it's probably not going to stop somewhere because engineers have different requirements than architects, than acoustic specialists, than building physicists, than developers. Either you have one big model that includes all the information for everybody, which is then too big to stand upright, or you have a number of different ones that somehow have to be smartly connected to avoid the usual problem of inconsistency. Someone's changing something here and not the other ones over there and following us. This is a completely unsolved problem today. And it's not a question of technology, it's not a question of the right tool, installing the right software on the computer. It's just a problem on the process. It's just a problem with the people working on the project. It's just basically a problem with people building up between units. So, the lesson is a model needs an objective. If you really want to have only the necessary information in the model, you need to have an objective to know what is necessary for the power. Which means an engineer coming with other necessities. Little physicist, which means they're going to build different models. And it's going to stay like that. I'm pretty sure it's going to stay. A hammer that can solve that probably needs different tools or different tools. And this is why our models usually are somehow in the center of it, but then sending data to everybody in the team in the form of the data. Sometimes it's even just Excel sheets for the engineers, sometimes it's FPV models, sometimes it's completely different stuff, sometimes it's G-code for the simulation. Everybody gets what he needs, but he has to be able to explain what he needs in the first place. And the model has to be able to serve it, and we always add in different things to the already existing data when we explore different things. So in the end, it's about collaboration. Back to IKEA again. This is straight out of the assembly instruction on my Billy shelf to assemble a few weeks ago. Or trying to do it alone. Ask somebody. It mustn't be necessary, us, although we would like to be much earlier in the process. But you have to be aware that building is a complicated thing. Many interdependencies in every project, and probably there's no head big enough to hold all this knowledge, so you have to talk to other people. Like in the question of a film project, now you want to have those continuous pinstripe suits from head to toe in the facade. This is the design request. The guys on the right hand side who are assembling those elements, of course, tell you in the first place, can we please have a connection detail? We don't have to measure in every single connection of those 12,500 boards to 1,700 curved beams, which makes 55,000 connections altogether. Can you please mill, take your fancy CNC cutting machine, mill a little notch into the curved beams for every single tiny board? And of course, the timber fabricator says it costs me 5 seconds per cut costs me times 55,000 about 2 weeks of extra machining time. The machine now comes at 115 Swiss francs a month. Achieve. If you're lucky enough, there's someone in the project who has the total view of all things. And you ask the other guys, how much would it cost to do this? Probably half a man be an expert in the assembly if you have to let everything touch in. And if you have both things on the table, the answer is pretty obvious. Of course, we're planning 55,000 seat cuts into those beams, and of course, we're using two extra weeks of machining time to actually cut that into the beams. Because A, they're saving half a man year of work, B, the quality will be right from the end. Because no one can make any mistakes anymore. If we've done the job correctly, and we work, except for the 40 boards that are messed up, then they can't make any mistakes anymore. This is actually what IKEA is also doing. If you have had the chance of assembling a few different TV shelves over the last, say, 10, I think it's 35 months old. Hasn't changed on the outside, more or less. It's still 80 by 2 meter by 30, looking quite the same. But internally, if you have built a few of those in the last 30 years, you have probably noticed that the construction principles change. And they make it more and more difficult to make mistakes in this area. Because the customer relations department obviously is telling them, hey, we're getting calls from all over the world and people are not understanding how we can do this. So you have to change something. And C, this ball doesn't fit into the wrong hole anymore. People can't make mistakes anymore. This is what we're trying to do. Then, of course, the steel guys says, we have understood that you want to have 1 millimeter tolerance on the outside because you want to have those continuous 10 millimeter gaps visible in the facade crossing the borders between facade elements, but we have to tell you a normal tolerance in steel is about 30 millimeters. This is what you can achieve on a structure like that. 35 meter cantilever. It's difficult to get it more precise in this construction method. So the question then is, you have to come up with an idea of a connection detail between the steel structure that's holding up everything and the facade element that is adjustable within those plus minus 50 millimeters. So that you can have this precisely prefabricated and pre-assembled facade element down to a millimeter basically, and hoisted up into this terribly imprecise support structure and still adjusted in a way that all the gaps are connected. This is the part that makes things interesting if you really want to build quality architecture. If you have to care about the detailing, if you have to care about the final appearance, this is what we're talking about. So the problem is building is a non-linear process. There's a lot of complexity in the process because really everything is somehow interconnected with everything. The geometry, the engineering, the planning, the sourcing, the logistics, the assembly, the fabrication, the detail. If you're lucky, they're all sitting around the same table and talking to each other. Usually they're not. If you have a responsive architect, he's trying to get them on the table, which is good. But then still they have to exchange means of communication. They have to talk about the same thing, and they have to talk about the same thing by means of a digital model if the project is so complex as the project we've seen. There's no other way of describing this geometry other in 2D plans and sections in the world. It's simply not working. You have to come up with it. This is actually the model is the message. The model that we build is the means of communication of project factors, because otherwise it's not possible to describe what is actually going to be built. And this is why we think that building model factors is actually a craft in itself. It takes a lot of experience. We somehow have to not only know what we're doing in terms of digital modeling, computer science, and handling the complexities on the side of the technology and the data, but you also looks like we're only doing two projects, which is unfortunate, I think. We're not really reserved to timber has turned out to be especially good to build it up around curves, because it's somehow we end up in the timber. If somebody has a nice steel or concrete project, please call us. I'm actually looking for something. So, thank you very much.
Expanding into the site, into moisture, the steel beam is expanding.
two ends, there's always stress somewhere. And we have to be aware that this is the case, and we have to take care that there's proper joinery mechanism that can take those movements and stresses, because they're going to be there, kind of the way. And this is not really, this is really the case in every building material that you're using. And you need to have a clever engineer on the team which knows about connection technology and means of putting things together. Architecture, tectonics, putting things together. Immigrated metalwork, and this is part of the game. And our part there, mostly actually, is to find out if it works geometrically. So finding out, okay, we have those 2,000 nodes of different geometries in the roof, and this is your proposal for the connection detail. Is it actually working in every single point? Is it also working in the worst case where you have the smallest angle or the biggest motion? That would be then our job to take this proposal by the engineers and put it on every spot and mm-hmm. check if it's working. Which also includes, for example, assembly. I mean, if you have to drive in a meter long screw through diagonally through a node, it has to go there, which means if it's not yet in there, you still have to have enough space in the back of the screw to put on the screw drive. If the next beam is already there, and those are things that really you have to check in those kind of structures, you have to check it every single node all the time, because the worst case is always something different in a different place. And this is then part of our things, that's the sort of quality control that we have to ensure that things are working not only in the final state but also in the assembly state. Yes, quite a bit. There is, for almost any project, except for the really small ones, usually there's a mock-up of the most difficult things, mostly on a one-to-one scale, which is actually the only way to really find out what's going on, especially if you have a number of different trades that have to. There has been a mock-up for the Kiln facade, about 10 square meters or something, just to check if it's possible. Right now we're working on a large scale project in Switzerland, and unfortunately not allowed to talk about yet. But it's going to be a 20,000 square meter roof, and they're actually building a mock-up of the whole facade thing. Inside of about 10 by 10 by 10 meters. So it's a single family house there. Costs probably $1 million to build a mock-up to test everything, which then gets to But this is actually what we have to do. Also, we have to, I mean, again, this is the question that we have here. If one thing works, then hopefully all the other 999 we're testing this, of course, on the first batch on the way. Are things coming out or not? So we're picking the worst case and trying to fabricate this on the real machine with the real material to see if it's really working. Otherwise, we can take the responsibility that all the others would also work. It depends. I mean, if you have different fabrication methods in the process, we are checking different things. Sometimes there is a combined mock-up where you test every technology. Sometimes there's really just a mock-up of one connection detail, for example. I don't want to miss the whole. Again, it's like in literature, it's also physical ones. They have to have an objective. You have to cleverly formulate the test case in a way that you pick something that will go wrong as likely as possible, because only if it goes wrong, you will find the error.
Do you think architects should provide an extremely accurate model, or should they be just able to explain that case in a different model?
I'd rather have the second case. I'm happy to take very precise and accurate model 3D geometry of any model. Usually it doesn't help if there's no one who can explain how it came to be. And then it's usually much easier to leave the model block and just explain what's going on in thinking. I'm perfectly aware that, in our experience, every time we enter a large-scale project which has one of these online storage spaces for the whole project, you know, those planned databases, and we usually get sorted into the visualization department because this is what 3D modeling is used for. And this is what people are thinking of at the time, and which is of course true. I mean, most of the 3D models that are out there in large scale architectural projects still are for visualization. Mesh geometries and somehow add together, and then the rest is being Photoshop. It's perfectly fine. I mean, you have to sell things by having clever visuals. But we are working on a different scale model, and it is no easy transition from one to the other. So for us, usually it's much easier if there's somebody who can actually explain how this geometry came to be, like this napkin sketch in the Chicago 1 project, where everything was lined out on a layer flow sheet. It takes us about 2 days to come up with a proper geometry. No, it's not that easy. But that would be the idea. And that is what I'm very grateful for in developments like Grasshopper. Suddenly the architects are able to talk about how geometry comes into being, which is great. I mean, I remember being in university and all my architecture colleagues who are properly studying architecture, not like I studied architecture on the site of computer science. Probably studying architecture, they were frustrated in courses like Darstellen, the Geometry, where they had to construct their pencils and rulers, some intersections between roof parts and stuff. And they were happy to get out of this as quick as possible. And then at one point, all those nice CAD programs came into being, and people thought we don't have to know about geometry anymore. Software's going to be careful to take care of. Now I have two planes and they intersect, I get the line. The computer computes where the line is and fine. And what we experienced in the beginning of our practice is that no one was able to actually describe geometry anymore. Which is now slowly changing because people are putting together those components in one software and suddenly you know, hey, this is a normal vector on the surface. And if you say, yeah, this is all, this beam is always standing perpendicular to the surface, this is a very valid information for us because this is basically but you have to have the vocabulary for doing this stuff. People are learning the vocabulary by using tools like Grasshopper, which is great. See this development in the world. There was a point where, as I say, the development of detailed information led to the graph tool. And this is probably still the case, just kind of you just know how to draw things so that they properly work. Someone has called this craftsman on speed, probably that's going on. But I think, on the one hand, I think architecture is defining itself probably a bit too much on the design side at this time. On the other hand, I'm actually pretty happy to see that all the words that were thrown out at the architecture schools 10 years ago because they didn't know how to properly design, but very well knew how to sort of details and problems, are now actually having a chance again because they can use those technologies and actually prove themselves fairly in the process. I'm looking forward to seeing more of that. Because we have problems of finding those people that are actually not trying to design it, but they're trying to find proper details. Are a bit probably, Swiss would say Dickfrischis. Someone who looks into the details and doesn't give up his own solve it. And this is what we're looking for, but still with a good knowledge about how architecture actually comes together and what architecture means. It's also the shape, the form, the visual impression, everything else, and the functionality, of course. Because we have to talk to everybody. Probably we have to understand somehow their intentions to expect all this learning information.
No, I was just I need this as one of the things. Maybe because people still
if I start to find those
things. This is what we're like. But sure, I mean one of the types of this for people, but on the other hand, they're also going that they try to understand the architect specifically. And I watched your diagrams that you had, and you talked to each other, and you said, so something I to do your name on the web, something you want to do your web, so much bigger. So that was a kind of field where people could communicate with that. But it seemed to me that it's you are that, let's say, the agent or the authority.
Yeah, in a way, what we do is actually to extract all the information and put it into a consolidated state, if you like, so it all fits together. This is what we're doing in the project. This is our role. So actually, you're proposing this, but the other guy, yesterday, proposed something that actually could not match this. This is essential continuity. It's actually about communication. It's actually about knowing the things that you do in very much detail. This is what I see as a problem at the moment, because in a large scale architecture project, you have 15 consultants around the table every 2 weeks in the meeting, but no one is really working on the project between those meetings in depth. That means no one really knows what's going on. And this is usually a bit different. We are entering the project because we are holding things down to a point where we have to know what's going on. And we're asking a lot of questions, and we're appealing to us about details and about measurements. And we cannot know what's going on, we don't know what we're doing, or much, much. Bigger focus and more about the dependencies. And I think this is maybe the main goal, and this is the main goal, probably also the main goal of an architect would be to define dependencies. I mean, you always have mutual dependencies here. Which is the leading one? Which one is defining this one? Others are following, and this changes over time. And I think the role that we sometimes have to take, because we didn't parametric models where some things rule and some things follow. That will also be the case in good process management and architectures to decide who's leading and who's following in this mess that we have, which will always be in this because it always depends from everybody else. If no one's doing the job, then we ask that the model will somehow have to take the risk in doing it. Sometimes not so sure. We're seeing right now, and we're trying to follow quite closely, is the development of the spin sector of the new information model, which is sometimes known as the big new architecture process. And we are pretty sure that there's a lot of development there, we just don't know if it's in the direction that we can follow. What we see is that still we are mostly hired by the fabricators have to do things in the end, instead of being hired a bit earlier in the process by people who actually decide about things. We all know this chart, and this is why I'm not showing it here, where you have the cost of decisions and the actual impact of decisions in the process and the process. The question really is, I've seen that on a nice graphic just yesterday, I think. In product design, the designer takes about 5% of the total cost of the end product. But his decision is actually influenced by 90% of the total cost. We're pretty cheap, actually. I think in architecture it's even worse. We're pretty cheap as consultants in a lot of fields concerning what actually is going to be built. And we're talking about large scale projects. €250 million altogether. The facade alone is about 5-6 million. To hire us for a few days early on in the project is a fraction, not even a fraction. But it probably leads to an early acknowledgement of the fact that you cannot build this from steel, but you can probably do it to two or three different engineers working on it here. It's always a question. I'm always having this question posed. If you hire them now, what's going to be the benefit in the end? The only thing I can say, in the end, you have to model the thing anyway. If you from everything, you can do it now or later. If you're lucky, you'll save a bit extra. If not, you pay this. I don't know where this profession is going. I don't even have a name for the profession I'm working other than the name of the company. I still give too long answers on questions because I don't know any short ones. And I still cannot describe what we're doing in less than half an hour before. This probably describes pretty much the state we're in. And somehow, in the middle of this whole process, and no one knows where to put us, not even ourselves. So I'm afraid I don't know what the future will be. No, we can't afford it. What we're using in almost all of the project is a simple €1,000 per license software that we put with our own developments to a point where we can actually do everything as far as now. I mean, sometimes we have to play a few tricks. The model of the kiln facade consists of 128 different RAM files that are automatically loaded. this is why the thing happened that I got the 2 million. But none of the other software is actually properly solves this problem. So it becomes better as a cheaper one. And the tool is not the precise. It's the people using the tool. Hopefully. Or otherwise, we would be out of business. I see the same things to do with the tool. Most of them are actually architects, so we're looking for the nerdy architects. If they're any here, give me a sometimes from the engineering side, but there is no official training for what we're doing today. I'm coming from the computer side of things, working my way towards architecture. Most of my colleagues are coming from the architecture side, and for one reason or another, work their way deeply into computer science. So this is where we need to borderlines.
Okay, we have one.